Aren't you glad? My Lord knows the way through the wilderness. Amen. Let's start with number 216 together. 216. Far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. Dwelling in Beulah land. Let's all stand together as we sing. 216 together. On that first.
Far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. Then I know the sins of earth beset on every hand. Doubt and fear and things of earth in vain to me are calling. None of these shall move me from Beulah land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky.
Praise God!
I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh, yet I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah land.
Let the stormy breezes blow,
let the stormy breezes blow, their cry cannot alarm me. I am safely sheltered here, protected by God's hand. Here the sun is always shining here. I am safe forever in Beulah land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky.
Praise God!
I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah land. Viewing here the works of God, I sing in contemplation. Hearing now his blessed voice, I see the way he planned. Dwelling in the Spirit here, I learn a full salvation. Gladly will I tarry in Beulah land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky.
Praise God!
I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah.
Great singing tonight. Good to see you back in church on Sunday evening. The Morelands are home.
Amen.
Good to see you folks. And this is JP Day. Good to see you, my friend. He was in India with us. And JP is a missionary somewhere in the Middle East. Jordan, that's right, Jordan. And him and Steve Troll, they're crazy. They're crazy. They take trips into Iraq. I mean, where you don't tell anybody where you're going. You know, they just go, I guess. And he's a wonderful, interesting guy. And check him out. And good to see you have your family with you tonight. Great. Didn't see them before. And good to have you folks with us. God bless you. They're going to get to stay up in the missionary apartment a little bit. And good to have you in the service. That's great. All right. Good service this morning. Looking forward to what the Lord has for us tonight, all right? Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we thank you for this evening. Thank you for another opportunity for us to gather together here Thank you, Lord, for the good music tonight. Thank you for this wonderful song we had to open the service. And Father, we bow before you to ask you to meet with us tonight. We need to hear from you this evening. And so, Lord, I pray that each of us would do our best to put out of our mind things that would occupy us and distract us from hearing what the Spirit would say to each one of us this evening. Will you control the service tonight and make it exactly what you want it to be? That we, you know that we need it to be, to help us and draw us closer to you because we were here this evening. May your will be done tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
Would you turn with me to number 441 in your hymnal? 441, I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. 441, let's sing that first together. I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me, and with the sunlight of his love did all my darkness flee. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Though clouds may gather in the sky and billows round me roll, however dark the world may be, I've sunlight in my soul. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Let's sing that last together. Soon I shall see him as he is, the light that came to me. Behold the brightness of his face throughout eternity. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his light within.
All right. Some announcements for us. Listen carefully if you would. And regular schedule now this week. The final night, Tuesday night, of the Grove City School of the Bible will be this Tuesday evening. All right, so those of you involved with that, 7 o'clock sharp on Tuesday night. And Brother Morland will be there to help wrap everything up for you for this semester. And that's Tuesday at 7, our midweek service here Wednesday night at 7, continuing our series on Wednesday night on separation. And I think that'll be a help and a blessing to you Wednesday night. And then right on through the week. We do want to remind you, ladies, you can get your tickets for the mother-daughter luncheon. Miss Wendy Burks, the wife of Brother Burks and the director of Reformers Unanimous International, will be here to be the speaker. She just had a new book come out during the conference, and a victim or a victorious. And is that right?
Yes.
A victim or victorious?
Yeah. Huh.
Victim or victorious. That sounds better, all right. I thought, boy, that's an odd title, isn't it? But it's a great little book on seven different women and whether they consider themselves to be victims or victorious. You'll enjoy, Mrs. Burke. So get your tickets. Mrs. Barham will be down in the lobby after the service tonight. Then remember, the Chick-fil-A missions for the teens, raising support for the teenagers, going on the missions trip to Mexico in June. Eat chicken and support missions, amen? And sounds like a plan to me. And that's April 25th, all right, from 5 to 8 p.m. at the Chick-fil-A down here in Stringtown Road, okay? So pass that around, get it on your social media, and spread the word. There are a few flyers down on the table if you want to personally hand some out. Take them to work, spread the word, let people know. Love to see that place packed out from 5 to 8 p.m. on Monday the 25th, a week from tomorrow night. Okay, we'll be saying more about that as we get closer. Okay, I think that all we've got right now. Let's take a moment. We'll welcome our guests that are with us in the service tonight. Anybody here tonight for the very first time? Brother Day and his family, of course, are here. Anybody else tonight? Right down here. Okay, who wants to do the talking? Is this yours for you, Bruce? Okay, Bruce, why don't you introduce him? Is that putting you on the spot? Too late now. You're there now. All right, great, man. He got you right down the front, didn't he? Huh? You can get him back later for that, all right? And Mom and Dad are with you over here tonight? Amen. Good to see them again. They've been here before, Brother John. Yeah, it's great. Glad you're here tonight. That's good. Bruce is going to be giving a testimony here shortly. He went to the Reformers Unanimous Conference with us, and we'll look forward to hearing from him when we hear from the others here in just a little bit. Anybody else? We're doing good? All right, if you'll take just a moment and fill out the welcome card, we appreciate you doing that. A little bit, we have the offering. Just put the card in there if you would, and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. We're glad you're here tonight. Let's give them a warm welcome, shall we?
Number 8989 mansion over the hilltop. I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, but I've got a mansion just over the hilltop. 89. We're going to sing all three stanzas together. On that first together. I'm satisfied with just a cottage below. City where the ransom will shine. I want a gold one, that silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in the land where we'll never grow old. And someday and tested, and like the prophet, my pillow was stone. And though I find here no permanent dwelling, I know he'll give me a mansion my own. I've got a mansion just over the hill. In that bright land where we'll never grow old, then someday under wander, but
don't think me poor or deserted or lonely. I'm not discouraged, I'm heaven bound. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a harp and a crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we'll nevermore wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold.
All right. Well, listen, if you're here tonight and you went to the Reformers Unanimous Conference, come on up and have a seat in the choir. We're going to have you come up and just give a brief testimony of what the Lord spoke to your heart about during the conference. And we're going to try to keep these 90 seconds or less, okay? Because let's see, there's how many are here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. What's that? Okay. About 9 or 10. And if everybody takes 5 minutes, we're here a long time. Okay, so we're going to try to keep it to 90 seconds or so. This was the 20th anniversary of Reformers Unanimous. They started 20 years ago in Rockford, and just a tremendous, tremendous conference there. Amazing testimonies. Everything is online. If there's not all there, it's going to be all there. Uploading all the sessions, the testimonies, just amazing. The changes in people's lives and the testimonies that are there. And some men, in fact, the man who runs the Reformers Unanimous now at Rockford is a 2005 graduate of their discipleship home. Came there as a cocaine addict, and God saved him, changed his life. He graduated from there, went to Bible college down in Louisville, Kentucky, Shawnee Baptist College, went on staff there, served assistant pastor for, I think, 5 years, and 2 years ago, they brought him back to North Love, and now he directs their program. And Johnny Wilt, what a great preacher. We heard a great message from him, and a great spirit. Another fellow we heard from New Jersey, who's now a director, came through their discipleship homes. That another fellow from another part of the country, just amazing to see God change lives. And it was a tremendous, tremendous week. On Friday night, they had almost 1,100 in the Friday night meeting that like we have in our churches throughout the time. And it was just outstanding. So the theme of the conference was In Him, in Christ, in Him. And so I want you to hear from these folks, and we'll have them come and share what the Lord spoke to their heart about during the conference, okay?
So ladies, if you have not signed up to go to our ladies' mother-daughter banquet, I highly suggest. I went to Wendy Burks's. We had so many that we could go to. She is a really awesome speaker. She spoke on, I'm not a victim, I'm victorious in Him. In Isaiah 48, 21, 22 says, and they thirst not when He led them through the desert. He caused the water to flow out of the rock. And she talked about the rock and how God is our rock, and that she gave us all a little pebble. And whenever you think of those hard times and those troubles, just turn to the rock. So it was an awesome conference. I'm excited to go back next year. Everybody was really great. So Mother's Daughter Banquet, ladies, you need to hear her. She's awesome.
We talked about in Him and having faith in Him. And one of the speakers was Dr. Kingsbury. And he talked about, are we suffocating our faith? But without faith, it's impossible to please God. And are we in Him every day and every on our personal devotions? And that was very good. I really enjoyed that. And one of my favorite parts was the testimonies. They had testimonies every night, video testimonies. And then on Friday, we had a bunch of testimonies. My favorite one was this lady. She was a drug dealer, she said, beforehand. She said these guys came to her door and knocked on her door, and she said, I tell you what, people, it was a miracle I let those guys go. She was the most feared woman in the neighborhood, And it was awesome how the Lord changed her life. Now she's living for Him and loves the Lord. I love this one testimony, and it just shows you the different people that come to RU. And she said what the Lord convicted her through is RU. She went to RU just to help and to work, and the Lord convicted her of self-righteousness. She said, I didn't even know. But the closer I got to God, the closer I was, more I was in Him, He just revealed self-righteousness. I love the RU ministry, and I love the conference.
Wow. I am so filled with joy. I feel like one of my daughters that came back from teen conference. For about 6 weeks, they have all this joy and high on the Lord and so forth, but I want to keep it. It was just incredible. I went to one a couple years ago, but this was unbelievable. The testimonies, one of the things that was very important to me that I enjoyed, we went to the ladies' home, and the ladies that were living there and that had graduated, they served us breakfast. It was buffet style, but it was a good breakfast. I mean, fresh fruit and eggs and so forth. And then they allowed us to go and see their rooms, and they had a room where they had, where things were donated, clothes, skirts, and so forth. And some of the ladies that came in off the street, and they had no idea how a lady was to dress or how she was to talk and so forth, and that was very impressive. And it was baby steps. Everybody has to learn because they don't know. And I talked to an older lady, more mature, I suppose, over 50, let's say, and she'd been there before, and she was back, and her sister was sponsoring her. And she was so thrilled. She sought out her sister, and she came up during one of the sessions and wanted to introduce me. And they had a broken relationship. And because of RU, many relationships are brought back together. There was people that didn't know their biological mother or father. They were reunited. It could bring you to tears, really, but it really brought joy to my heart to know. And how all this happens is that we need to go to Jesus' feet. And there was many sermons we've heard pastor talk about, but we do need to go to Jesus' feet. I mean, he talked about Mary and Martha and how those stories that we well know. And then another one that really spoke to me was the voice, you know, and how, you know, the country fair is coming. And I love going visiting, and I probably don't do it like I should do it anymore because there's other things that are in front of it. But I told Pastor I really, really have to make time for that somehow, even if I go to one visit during the week. I love leading people to the Lord. It's one of the most exciting things to do. And I think about my children, my adult children. I want my children to go next year. I know my daughter's on a journey to success now, and how I could see how this would help. And one of the ladies that was in the breakfast, her name was Stacy. We exchanged phone numbers. And she had shared, she rolled up her long sleeves. She has scars of what she had done. They found her dead, basically, almost dead. And she was part of the ladies, I think they called them joy bells, and singing. And one of the ladies, the husband and wife, was a team that took care of these ladies in the group home. And they both had been through the addiction and so forth. Addiction can be anything. It doesn't have to be cigarettes or drinking. It can be food, it can be anger, it can be anything. And I got into RU because I felt like I needed to learn discipline, more discipline in my life. I'm basically what we call a seasoned Christian, and been saved more than half of my life. And I'm closer to God today because of RU. And I gotta start saving your change or something. Anybody could go, I think, but I just want to encourage anybody that's in RU, you really, really have to go. It's just life-changing.
I just started with RU, and most people think of RU as addictions to narcotics and alcohol. There was testimony there about immorality and other addictions that we don't even think about. An addiction to me now, after this class that we had for 4 days, is anything that you put before God, and it can be anything, clothing, shopping. Every one of you should come to RU on Friday night and just listen to the testimonies of what we overcome to be with God. NA and AA is not going to survive because RU survives because God is with us. And through him and in him, we will succeed.
That would help. the conference was everything I was hoping for and then some. I loved how everybody had different testimonies and how uplifting the entire conference was. Like everyone else said, it's not just the drug addictions or the alcohol addictions or what everybody has some sort of addiction, and it teaches you talks about putting Christ first, how to live your life walking with God and all that. It was probably the best experience I've ever had in my entire life.
Come on.
Wow. I don't know where to begin that. It's really in depth, and far as the Bible, the Word of God, it's so in depth, and far as the preaching and everything, and what I got out of it is, I like what Brother Ben Brooks was preaching about. He was preaching about we need voices for Jesus. We need voices to get the word out. We need voices to tell the lost about Jesus. And they got these motorcycles. These people that wear vests, and they got crosses on the back of the vest, and the cross draws people, to Jesus. And they go around and they tell people about Jesus. And that's what one thing that I like. And the second thing that I like, what he was preaching about the roadblocks on a recovery, performing and not transforming. And you can do all the outward things, do all the challenges, but if you're not letting God conform you, because God works on the inside, he transforms you. His word transforms you from the inside, and there's got to be a change. And you can do all the outward things, but you're putting your focus on yourself, not on Christ. And leaving addictions but cleaving to behaviors. And I like what Pastor was like, I like what he touched on that, about how Mr. Slabaugh, Pastor was saying that he's, his wife goes out there and plucks up the flowers from off the, plucks the flowers.
The weeds.
The weeds, not the flowers. and he's talking about shaving, but like you gotta get to the root of the problem. You gotta get to the root of the problem, and change has gotta come from inside. It's a heart problem. You gotta be filled with the Spirit and let God change you.
Well, I would say that it was a phenomenal time. And, of course, you can say that, but it doesn't actually do it justice. One of the things that I drew from it is it's easy over time to get into the mechanical mode of doing what you do and not the spirit and in him, if you will. And that was that's something I've been that he showed me, that I need to get back to that point and not do the things you do just because it's what you do when it comes to your service. The other thing is that it's just amazing, the testimonies of the people and the changes that God has made in their lives, and just phenomenal. Thank you.
This was the first conference that I have ever been to, and it was absolutely amazing. I definitely learned to have a lot more faith and gonna have to be more obedient. And the testimonies were probably one of the best parts of it. No judgment, just all joy and victory.
It was a fantastic conference. It was being the 20th anniversary, or 20th birthday, if you would, of RU, it had a little bit of different feel. It was more of a exciting party atmosphere, if you would. I mean, it was just an exciting time, and it was a great time. Not that it wasn't sincere, and it definitely was. Not that it didn't have all the other components, but it was just it was a very, very exciting time. One of the couple of people spoke on sadness, and Dr. Krabby, he talked about sadness versus depression, and explained how, you know, the vast majority of folks who are down in the depths of despair really not depressed. They're sad, and sadness isn't always necessarily a bad thing. And there's a great message there. And later on, Ryan Giles spoke on a subject that was just really fascinating to me to think about. And this is so applicable in every area of our life, not just if we're, you know, trying to get over, you know, pornography or drugs or alcohol or prescription drugs or whatever, but it can be anything that we have in our lives that we're just not willing to give up. I believe Paul has said, if something that's come between you and God, then that's an addiction. It's something that you continue to do, that even though you know it's not good for you. And that is suffering. And sometimes we say, you know, it's so hard, and we think we should be able to just let go of this without it being hard. But being hard is okay, and suffering is okay. I want to read just a couple little quotes from Ryan Giles when he talked about the value of suffering in victory. He said, many people stay in an addiction because they are simply unwilling to suffer what it takes to walk away from it. Now, this can be your prescription drugs, it can be alcohol, it can be anger, it can be your depression, it can be your covetousness and greed, any of those, anything. They've not prepared for the discomfort, irritation, or pain of that moment, so they indulge. I mean, that's powerful. The level of pain you're willing to endure directly relates to the victory you will see. The level of pain you're willing to endure directly relates to the victory you will see. And that was just one of those pieces that just really stood out to me, and it was fantastic. We had a great time, got to know one another better. There was 18 of us that went, and just had a fantastic time. I believe we had the most delegates, at least in the one time he had asked in the room, we had the most delegates from any church in the country, which is pretty exciting as well. But we just are excited to see what God's going to do. We have our 5-year anniversary coming up this August, September, and just looking forward to seeing what God's going to do in another 5 years and 10 years and 15 years. So it was fantastic.
The illustration that Ryan Giles used, he had shattered his elbow, and they had to eventually do surgery and put some pins in it, and he couldn't move hardly, and he had to go to physical therapy. He called it physical torture. How many ever had a knee replacement or something like that, and you had to go through, okay? And the guy, he could get it so far, not all the way, but to there, and he said, you know, the further you get it now, the more you'll get to use it later. And if you settle for this, that's what you'll have. And so he said, and he said, I can't get it all the way out like this one. He said, because I only went that far. That's all the pain I would endure. And he said, so that's how much I use. And that's when he's saying the level of pain you endure today may determine your usefulness tomorrow and what God will be able to do with you. It was excellent. Just sermon after sermon. Pastor Kingsbury brought, was it three messages on the just shall live by faith? Four times that's mentioned in the Bible. He preached for an entire year on those four instances. He took 3 months on each one. And he crammed all that into three sermons for us. But it was incredible. Just amazing messages on the just shall live by faith. You will pull it up. Pull up the testimonies, the messages. Get some time when you can just have a little private time by yourself. You'll be blessed. You really will. It was fantastic. All right. And thanks to all those who went. And mark it on your calendar. I think it's April 26th through 24th through 26th. Okay. It's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday next year. Is that right? Okay. And so we'll make sure we have those dates and start planning on it. It's a great, great time. And if you just want to develop a real intimate relationship with Jesus Christ and learn what it is to really know God, then you ought to come to RU and be a part of the program. You will be amazed at what God will do in your heart and life. It's an incredible, incredible discipleship program. It really is. Life-changing tool. All right. Everyone take a songbook. We'll sing again together. Number 507, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Number 507. Once you have it, let's stand together and Brother Bob will lead us.
Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy grace, streams of mercy ever. Songs of loudest praise, teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love.
Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, he to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Let's sing that last together. As you find your seats, you're going to feel really awkward when the piano stops and you're still standing in the middle of the aisle. Let's find our seats as we sing that, "Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be." On that last together, "Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above."
All right, you can be seated if you will, and the ushers are coming, and they'll receive our offering tonight. Anybody not in their seat yet gives an extra $100. Seems right to me. Get you back in your place when you're supposed to. Amen. All right, we'll pray and we'll ask God's blessing on our offering tonight. Brother Wallace, lead us in our prayer, please.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for being such a great God. Lord, we would just meditate a while on how insignificant we are and how great you are. Lord, it would help us to rely on you for everything. Lord, help us to be patient. Help us to be willing to open up our minds, our hearts tonight, that you can speak to us and give us the understanding that we need to have a stronger walk with you. Father, bless the offering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Take your Bibles this evening, if you would, and open them to Luke chapter 10 for our scripture reading. Luke chapter 10, please. Luke 10, we're going to read verses 38 through 42, the end of the chapter, and we read the verses responsively. We begin together on verse 38, then I read 39, together again on 40, until we end together on verse number 42 of Luke chapter 10. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 38 of Luke chapter 10. Ready? Now it came to pass, as they went, that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving, and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me. Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. But one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her. And let's pray, shall we? Father, we bow before you now this evening. We thank you, Lord, already for what we've heard tonight by way of the music and the testimonies. And Lord, thank you so much for the work you did in the hearts of those who are at the conference. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in and through the servants of God in Rockford, and what you're doing in and through the servants of God in this place on every Friday evening. Now, Father, we pray that you'll speak to us now through your word tonight. We thank you for the Bible. We thank you, Lord, for giving us your words. And I pray we'd give our attention to your words tonight. Lord, I pray that you would help us again to focus and to concentrate and not let our minds wander and miss what you have for us this evening. Bless the special now in Jesus' name. Amen.
All of grace is my story, all the way from earth to glory. Since by grace he lifted me from sin and woe, living grace he has extended, as on him my heart depended, and he'll give new discovered grace, not yet uncovered grace from his bountiful shore. Grace to cross a river, grace to face forever. There'll be new grace I've not needed before. There's been grace for every trial,
there's been grace for every mile,
there's been grace sufficient from his vast supply. Grace to make my heart more tender,
grace to love and pray for sinners,
that there'll be new grace when it's my time to die. Discovered grace, not yet uncovered grace from his bountiful store. Grace to cross the river, grace to face forever. There'll be new grace I've not needed before. There'll be new.
Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer as we come to the preaching of your word. Lord, I ask for your help as I bring the message this evening, and I pray, Lord, that you will help those who listen tonight. Lord, it's warm, and we'll have to listen on purpose this evening. I pray, Lord, that you would give us all ears to hear what the Spirit would say to the church tonight. Help me to say what I ought to say and leave unsaid what doesn't need to be said. Lord, I pray that you'd help each of us tonight as only you can do. In Jesus' name, amen. I spoke this morning about people who sat at the feet of Jesus. And tonight I want to talk to you about why I sit at the feet of Jesus. It's actually the same sermon, I just changed the title. But I'm kidding. But we talked about the sinner at the feet of Jesus this morning, the woman who came while he was at the dinner with the Pharisee. We talked about the new Christian at his feet, the maniac after he got saved and sat at the feet of Jesus. When we talked about Jairus, the man who needed a miracle, and he came and to the feet of Jesus. And then we talked about the seasoned Christian, the mature Christian who was at the feet of Jesus, and that was Mary, who we read about tonight in Luke chapter 10. You know, there's certain people in the Bible, you hardly can mention one without mentioning another. I think of these two sisters here in the Bible. You don't hardly ever hear Mary and without the mention of Martha. Aquila without Priscilla. I think Paul and Barnabas. Maybe Paul and Silas. You just tend to put people together. Samson and Delilah. It just kind of goes together. When you say one, you think of the other one. And that's the way it is with Mary and Martha. But the amazing thing about these two sisters is how opposite they were. They were complete opposites in personality. Martha was very outspoken. Mary was very quiet. Martha was very emotional, while Mary would be very reserved. Martha was constant motion, and Mary would stop to ponder things and think about things. Martha would not like rainy days. Mary would look forward to rainy days where she could curl up and read a book. Yeah, some Marys in the crowd. Opposites. But you know what? Both of them still saved. Both of them who loved Jesus. Both of them who served Jesus. And they both lived for Jesus. Jesus visits their home was not an unusual thing to do. He was a regular visitor at their house. And they enjoyed having Jesus come and fellowshipping with him. And as they're both sitting, and I want you to notice, they both are sitting at his feet. Verse 39 says, she had a sister, Martha, and it says she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. So they both sat there and listened to his word for a while. But apparently, it got to be close to dinner time, and Martha said, we better get something ready. And she begins to get up, and I could see her going to where the pots and pans are, or the dishes, and she's for sure making sure that she bangs a few pans and, you know, clashes a few dishes, makes some noise, you know, to make sure that everybody knows I'm out here working. And I'm doing it all by myself out here. Surely somebody ought to come help me. You say, well, how do you know she was thinking that, preacher? Because she verbalized that soon to Jesus. Finally, she came back to where Mary was sitting at Jesus' feet, and she complains to Jesus. She's like, she was cumbered about much serving. And she says, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Lord, don't you care about me? Boy, her eyes were on the right person, weren't they? Who were her eyes on? Herself. Boy, God, don't you care about me? It's the focus. And she thinks Jesus is going to take a seat. Martha says, hey, Jesus is here. We need a big meal. Jesus here, this has to be something special. And I think Mary would have said, how about a pan of hot water and some mac and cheese? And we can keep on talking to Jesus. How about something simple like some spaghetti in that water, and let's just keep fellowshipping with Jesus. Totally different viewpoints. And Jesus, instead of saying, yeah, you poor thing, you're right, you shouldn't do that all by your little self, he didn't do that. He looked at her and he rebuked her. He said, Martha, you're careful, full of care, and troubled about many things. says in verse number 41. Verse 42, but one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. Said Martha, it's not wrong to serve, but you should desire to sit at my feet also. You should desire to sit at my feet as well. Now, can I tell you something tonight? I think if we could look at the room tonight, we'd find both Mary and Martha's. But I think inside of each of us, there's Mary, and I think there's some Martha in each one of us. You know, you thinking there's some men here tonight. Brother Day is a missionary, and Brother Moreland, and different ones that are full-time, as we say, in service for God. And you think, well, yeah, you guys, man, just get up and get to study the Bible all day. You know, do you know that I get up in the morning and there's a million things I think to do besides study the Bible? Are you that way, Brother Day? And you know what? It's just easy for us to get up and take off and be Martha, as it is for you to get up and take off and be Martha. There are situations to take care of, and people to talk to, and things to get accomplished, and things to get done, and things that have to get organized, and things that have to get detailed, and things that have to be led. And man, you can jump right in and go and be Martha. And I've done that enough, and I've been cumbered about much serving because I didn't take the needful part, and that's sit at Jesus' feet. So I want to talk to you tonight about why do we sit at Jesus' feet. I'm not going to keep you long. I'm going to give you three simple principles or reasons why we sit at Jesus' feet. Because number one, you will not serve God effectively publicly unless you sit at His feet privately. You are not going to serve God effectively publicly unless you sit at His feet privately. Should we serve? Absolutely. Should we labor for the Master? Yes. Should we endeavor to win others to Christ? Yes. Should we want to see people baptized and added to the church and helped in their lives and their life changed? Yes. But not at the expense of not sitting at His feet. A.B. Simpson was an evangelist and also a songwriter. He wrote these words, "Once it was the blessing, now it is the Lord. Once it was the feeling, now it is His word. Once His gift I wanted, now the giver own. Once I sought for healing, now Himself alone. Once was painful trying, now it's perfect trust. Once a half salvation, now the uttermost. Once 'twas ceaseless holding, now He holds me fast. Once was constant drifting, now my anchor's cast. Once it was busy planning, now it's trustful prayer. Once it was anxious caring, now He has the care. Once it was what I wanted, now what Jesus says. Once it was constant asking, now it's ceaseless praise. All in all forever of Jesus will I sing. Everything in Jesus and Jesus everything." That's a great song and great truth that he wrote. You see, we spoke this morning. It's not just to know Him as your Savior. It's not just receiving Him to save you from hell. It is knowing Him and walking with Him and talking with Him. That is the needful part. Don't serve the Master and forget the Master. Don't run the race and forget who you're running the race with. How much time did you spend at His feet in the last 7 days? I mentioned this morning, a good marriage is more than just saying "I do" at the altar. You never talk to any husband and wife been married for any length of time, and you say, "How's your marriage going?" "Oh, you know, our wedding was so beautiful. You know, the vows we created, they were just so nice. And I remember him saying, I do, and I said, I did, and man, it was so great, and man, the people were there, and it was beautiful, and the decoration was great." Wait a minute, I didn't ask about your wedding. That's how your marriage is. Number one complaint from wives about their husbands. Know what it is? We don't spend enough time together. Or he doesn't talk to me. We don't spend enough time talking with each other. Well, hey, man, I said I loved you when we got married. If anything changes, I'll let you know. Yeah, see how that works in your relationship. But I'm fearful that some people think their relationship with Jesus is that way. Tell me about your salvation. Oh, I got saved when I was 9. I got saved when I was 7. I got saved when I was 12. I didn't ask you about your wedding day. How's your relationship with Jesus Christ? How's your relationship with Him? It's difficult to convince someone that you love them if you do not spend time with them and you do not talk to them. That's why the wife feels so unloved. Man, if you don't want to spend time with her, you don't talk to her, she feels like you don't care about her. Let me ask you a question. How's God feel about you tonight? Based on how much time you spent with Him and how much time you spoke with Him this week. Charles Spurgeon said he wanted to so live that when he'd look up to heaven and say, I love you, Lord, that the Lord could look over the banister of heaven and look down and say, I know it, Charles. I know it. We said this morning, it's not just difficult to live the Christian life. It is impossible. And you end up being a Martha that it's cumbered about your service. Well, doesn't anybody else do anything around this church? Do I have to do it all? How come no one else is here doing this? How come just 3 of us are here? What's up with that? Well, Martha, I can tell you haven't sat at Jesus' feet. Let me give you number 2. I can tell you're enjoying this. Because this is number 2. There is no discontentment at Jesus' feet. Why would you sit at Jesus' feet? Because I want to be effectual in serving God. Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount, He said that your Father which sees in secret will reward thee openly. You want open blessings, you be what you should be in secret with God. You sit at His feet. Number 2, you find out there's no discontent at the feet of Jesus. Martha was complaining about Mary, but let's see. What were Mary's complaints about Martha? What verse were they in? I don't think I remember seeing those. Maybe I don't have the right version of the Bible. Is there a complainer's version? There's a version for everything else. I think maybe there might be a complainer's version of the Bible. Maybe it's in there. You know what? There was no complaint from Mary. Why? She's sitting at Jesus' feet. She wasn't complaining at all. To see the work of God properly, to see the servants of God properly, to see other believers properly, you must spend time at the feet of Jesus. Or you will be unfocused and out of focus in how you view the work of God and the people of God. I believe when you're at His feet, you won't be critical. I believe when you're at His feet, you won't be condemning. I believe when you're at His feet, you won't be judgmental. You aren't going to have a bad spirit. Turn over with me. You're in Luke. Turn over with me to John 21, would you please? John 21. John 21 is where Peter decides to go fishing. Now, when Peter says, I go a-fishing, it's different than when you decide on a Saturday morning or another weekday morning, I'm going down and do some fishing. Peter, before he became a follower of Jesus Christ, was a fisherman. Commercial fisherman. He did it for a living. And the text here, the tense that he uses is an ongoing tense. In other words, Peter's saying, I'm going to go fishing. I'm going to keep on going fishing. Just like when Jesus said, ask and it shall be given unto you. That's not just a one-time thing. That's a continual asking, a continual sense. Ask and ask and ask and ask and keep on asking. Seek and seek and seek and keep on seeking. And knock and knock and knock and keep on knocking. Here, that's the same tense that is used when Peter says, I'm going fishing. I'm going to keep. In other words, I'm going back to what I know to do. Why would Peter want to do that? Well, he just messed up big time. He just, by the fire outside the palace of Pilate's judgment hall, a little girl had come up and said, yeah, you're one of his followers. No, I'm not. 3 different times he denied that he even knew the Lord. And just in case they said, hey, I think you talk like one of his followers. He said, oh, yeah. Blankety blank, blicker blacker, wicker blicker, slider rib. He just let loose a string of cuss words. Try to prove that he didn't know Christ. And you know what? There's a window there, the Bible says, and Jesus looked out that window, and he looked up, and Peter looked up, and he saw Jesus. And the cock crew. Peter went out and wept bitterly. He disappointed the Savior, and he thought, I blew my chance. I'm going back to fishing. Needless to say, it's not a time where you would say he was close to Jesus. All right? So he's going back to fishing, and here's what happens. Verse 4, the morning was now come. Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus said unto them, children, have you any meat? And they answered him, no. Only one thing worse than fishing all night and not catching anything, and that's fishing all night, not catching anything, and someone asks you if you caught anything. That's worse. Okay? He said to them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. And they cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes. Well, that would have struck somebody's memory, wouldn't it? Therefore that disciple whom Jesus loved said unto Peter, it is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girded his fisher's coat onto him, for he was naked, and did cast himself into the sea. And the other disciples came in a little ship, for they were not far from land, but as it were 200 cubits, dragging the net with fishes. And they were come to the land, they saw the fire of coals thereon, and fish laid thereon, and bread. And Jesus said unto them, bring the fish which ye have now caught. And of course they brought the fish up. Jesus says in verse 12, come and dine. And nobody says a word. Nobody asks him, who art thou? They knew it was the Lord. And this is the third time, verse 14, that Jesus showed himself to disciples after he was risen from the dead. So they're eating, and there's basically silence. Jesus breaks the silence by asking Peter a question. And remember, he asked Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, he said, lovest thou me more than these? Peter, don't you love me more than you love these fish? And of course, Peter said, Lord, you know I love you. And he went through that 3 times with the 3 denials, and we understand all that, but he then tells Peter how he's going to die. Verse 18, verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. This spake he, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said unto him 2 words. What are they, church? Follow me. Now, why do you think? It's interesting how Jesus would tell him how he's going to die, and he'd say, no, it's important, you follow me. And somehow, that went off Peter like water off the duck's back. Because the next verse. Peter, turning about, seeth the disciple whom Jesus loved following, and that's John, by the way. That's how John refers to himself in his book often, as the disciple whom Jesus loved, which also leaned on his breast at supper, and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? And Peter, seeing him, saith to Jesus, Lord, what shall this man do? So Peter said, all right, that's why I'm going to die. I want to know how John's going to die. What are you going to do with him? And Jesus saith unto him, if I will that he tarry till I come, What is that to thee? Follow thou me. Jesus was being pretty kind. But he basically was saying, it's none of your business what I do with him. You're supposed to be following me. You know, when you sit at Jesus' feet, you look at him. You don't look at anybody else. And when you see the Lord, the things of earth grow strangely dim. And by the way, people grow strangely dim. And you'll find that the only one you want to please is him. The only one that you want to put a smile on his face is him. And you'll find that you want him to use you and work in your life, and you don't care about performing for the other people. So it doesn't matter who's doing it, who isn't doing it, who else is helping, who isn't helping. All you know about it, Jesus, am I doing what you want me to do? Whenever you get the feeling like, well, no one else is doing this, I'm the only one doing this, or I'm working and no one else is working, or, man, 10% of the people carry 100% of the load, you need to say, maybe I need to get at the feet of Jesus some more. Because I've got a discontented spirit, a discontented attitude. And I need to spend some time with Jesus. And about the time you think, well, what are they doing for God? How are they serving in the church? You know what you ought to hear ringing in your ears? What is that to thee? Follow thou me. Follow thou me. The song says, now it is Jesus and me for each tomorrow. For every heartache and every sorrow, I know that I can depend upon my newfound friend. And so to the end, it's Jesus and me. That's the theme. Let me give you the third reason you sit at Jesus' feet. When you sit at Jesus' feet, you simplify your life. You simplify your life. Notice what he said to Martha in Luke 10. He said, Martha, you're careful and troubled about many things. Many things. I believe this. I believe if the devil and his crowd cannot get you away from God with badness, he'll do it with busyness. It's not that you don't, well, I'd like to spend time with God. I mean, I'd like to get up and spend time, sit at Jesus' feet, but man, I don't have the time. I'm just so, yeah. You've heard it. Maybe you've said it. I don't know if any of you caught the one fellow on Friday night that gave his testimony at Reformers Unanimous about how God transformed his life. And then he testified, I get up at 4 a.m. every day so I can spend time with Christ, have a relationship with him. So, it's a little fanatical, isn't it? Not if he's transformed your life, it isn't. When I was... My first car was a 1969 Volkswagen. Can I call that a car? I didn't have to pedal it, so it would be a car. Though sometimes I think bicycles passed me, but I won't say that. But and you know what? Little green bug. That then sometimes in the wintertime, I was scraping the inside of the windshield as much as the outside of the windshield. As I'm driving to work on a cold morning. My wife, I did not go directly to college right out of high school. I stayed out a year and worked and didn't know what really the Lord wanted me to do. In fact, God changed my plans during that year. My wife went away to a Christian college and I made plans in October of that year to drive to see her. It's a 12-hour drive in my Volkswagen. Did you know? And I knew they had a program at the college that night that started at 6 p.m. So I knew I had to be in by about 4 p.m. So I got to get up and be on the road at 4 a.m. You know what I didn't say? I didn't say 4 a.m. You kidding me? I can't get up that early. That thought never entered my mind. I was up and at 3 a.m. and getting ready and getting dressed, loading the car, getting the old thing ready to go. Huh? That was nothing. In 12 hours, now listen, you got to know something. I'm not a fan of driving. I usually drive about an hour, and I'm like, I'd never make deputation, brother, never. Thank God my wife loves to drive. And she, I let her drive. On that trip to Rockford, Brother Bruce drove all the way there and all the way back. That wasn't a problem. You know why? I wanted to see Kathy Lash. That was no problem at all. When I want to see Jesus, if I want to sit at his feet, I want to have that relationship with him. Isn't that worth getting up a little early in the morning? Isn't that worth laying aside, well, I'm just not a morning person. Sometimes we talk about husbands and wives and listen, I talk about husbands and wives because Paul said, I show you a mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. I speak concerning Christ and really the believer. That relationship. And you don't use those excuses on your spouse. If there's a certain way, if the love language of your spouse is affection or words, and you say, oh, I'm just not one to say nice things. Well, if you're going to love your wife, you learn to say nice things. Hello? If it's acts of service and she needs you to help around the house, that shows that you love her, you better start doing some acts of service. Do you love the Lord Jesus? Then you simplify your life to be able to spend time with him. I think the devil will throw anything in your life to keep you occupied and tired enough to keep you away from God. If you're too busy to sit at his feet every day, you're entirely more busy than God ever intended for you to be. And you need to simplify your life. Don't equate spiritual activity with spirituality. Don't think because I'm involved, I'm doing this, and I'm doing that, and I'm doing this, and I'm doing that. Boy, I must be spiritual. No, you're busy. But it doesn't mean you're spiritual. Mark 3 and verse 14. You're in Luke. Go to your left to Mark chapter 3. We're almost done. Mark chapter 3. Jesus has chosen his disciples, 12 of them. Verse 13 of Mark 3 says, he goeth up into a mountain and calleth unto him whom he would, and they came unto him. And he ordained, how many, church? 12, that they should be with him and that he might send them forth to preach. And they'll have power to heal sicknesses and cast out devils, and then it names who the 12 were. A lot of times we think, well, he chose 12 and sent them out to preach. No, there's one thing that happened before that. Look at it again, verse 14. He ordained 12, number one, that they should be with him. Then, that thee might send them forth to preach. Before you go out and preach, before you go out and tell somebody about Jesus, what's the first thing you're supposed to do? Be with him. Be with him. Played basketball through high school and college. You know, in basketball game, each team gets a set amount in each half. They get a set allotment of timeouts. Okay? Now, they're playing the game. Why do you need a timeout? What do the players do when there's a timeout? Oh, what do? They talk to the coach. If the coach doesn't like the way things are going, they're not carrying out the game plan that they practiced and they worked on, he's going to call a timeout. And what is it? They all come over to the coach. And they don't come over and talk to the coach. They come over for the coach to talk to them. Don't they? And get them all back on the same page again. And get them back following the blueprint again. Why? Hey, listen, because some guy decides to do his own thing. Some guy decides that, well, you're going to play man-to-man, I'm playing zone. Some of you don't know what that means at all, do you? In other words, I'm not going to guard a man. This is my spot right here. And anybody comes through here, I'll guard him. But other than that, you guys are on your own. You know what's going to happen? You're going to be in trouble. Some guy is going to be unguarded. Can't do your own thing. You know what he's going to do? He's going to call timeout, call it over, and say, what are you doing? You know, if you want to stay in the game, you got to follow what we're saying to do here. Do you understand? Now, suppose there's a timeout called, and all the players start to head over, and one guy stays out, and he's got the ball, and he's going to shoot free throws. Say, hey, Mike, it's a timeout. I know, but I thought I'd practice my free throws during this timeout. You guys go ahead. Everybody looks at, what are you thinking? Timeout isn't to practice free throws. Timeout, and he's just going down the court, and he just keeps dribbling and going in circles and doing between his legs. He says, what are you doing? I'm going to practice my dribbling during this timeout. No. Timeout is to talk to the coach. You know what sitting at the feet of Jesus is? It's not time to practice your soul winning. It's not time to practice your teaching lesson. It's not time to practice what you do for God. You know what it's time to do? It's time to listen to the Lord. It's time to listen to God. It's time to have a discussion with the coach. It's time to allow him to give you the game plan for the day. Or you don't come anywhere close to winning the game. Now listen, we can't be all Martha, all service, and we're not going to be all Mary, always sitting and fellowshipping with Jesus. But I tell you what happens. When you spend time with Jesus and you sit at his feet, it makes serving him enjoyable. Then it's not something you endure. It's something you enjoy. You'll enjoy sitting in an hour and a half church service as much as the people enjoyed sitting 3.5 hours out in 80-degree sun at the horseshoe yesterday. Not against enjoying that. Go and have a good time. But don't complain when church goes an hour and a half. Hello? Nobody, you don't sit at the, I don't know if anybody ever sits at a Buckeye game and says, man, is this thing ever going to get over? Doesn't happen. You can serve him and not sit at his feet. Absolutely. But the difference is between, the same difference between driving the car and pushing the car. It's no fun pushing a car. Let's run out of gas. Sure is fun to drive one. Let's not neglect the one thing that's needful. That's sitting at his feet. You know, it's interesting. If we would just think, all we do is at his feet. Because the Bible says the heavens are his throne. And the earth is his footstool. We serve even at his feet. We talked this morning about one day when we see him. When John saw the glorified Christ, he fell at his feet. That's what we'll do one day. we'll fall at his feet and worship him. We'll worship him. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. And he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. And you'll be glad you sat at his feet. Father, we pray you'll take the blessing, the message tonight, and use it as a blessing in the lives of people this evening. I pray, Lord, that you'd create a hunger and a thirst in our heart, a passion to sit at your feet, to want to be with you, and allow you to impact our life. Help us to understand that to know you and to love you and to fellowship with you is your desire. And Lord, to know you and love you and fellowship with you creates a desire in us to want to live our lives for your honor and your glory and to serve you. For when we love you, we'll keep your commandments. But our motivation is love. Lord, I pray tonight you'd help the folks in this room. Some are struggling with public ministry because they know privately they're not what they need to be with you. Help them sit at your feet. Some are very discontented and maybe critical in their spirit and their attitude. Help them to desire to sit at your feet and to follow you. God, I pray that you'd help us to simplify our lives, get rid of some of the busyness that is coming between us and sitting at your feet. That Mary hath chosen that needful part, which can never be taken away from her. Help us to choose the needful part. Make it the priority of our life. That we get with our coach, our Lord, every day. And execute the game plan the way you want us to execute it. For that's the path to victory. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. But right now, with your heads bowed, just between you and God, I wonder how many folks in the room tonight would say, Pastor, if I died tonight, I know 100% sure that I would go to heaven. There's no doubt in my mind. I know that I'm saved. Would you slip your hand up for a moment that I may see it as a testimony? Just say, Pastor, I know that I'm saved. All right, you may put it down. I wonder if you tonight would say, Pastor, if I died tonight, am I 100% sure? No, I didn't know anybody could be 100% sure. The Bible says that these things are written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that you have eternal life. God says you can know. And if you're here tonight and you don't know for sure, would you allow me to pray for you? I'll not embarrass you, will not call you out, but I certainly would pray for you to the Lord. You say, Pastor, I'm not sure if I died I'd go to heaven, but I appreciate you praying for me tonight. I am concerned about that. Would you slip your hand up and put it back down right now and just say, Pastor, pray for me tonight? God bless you. I see it. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. And you. Thank you. I see those. Anyone else will join these this evening? Thank you, young man. I see that hand. Wonder how many believers here tonight would say, Pastor, God spoke to my heart about sitting at the feet of Jesus. And Pastor, I appreciate you praying for me. I need, that needs to be a priority in my life. I think a lot of the struggles and the difficulties and the problems I encounter because it hasn't been a priority in my life. And I'm asking God to give me that desire to sit at His feet. Pastor, God spoke to my heart tonight. Will you pray for me? Will you slip your hand up, Christian? Yes. Yes. Amen. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. It's an opportunity for those who God has spoken to their heart to respond to what God said and come and kneel at an altar and talk to the Lord about what He's spoken to their heart about. But if you're here tonight and you slipped your hand up and said, I don't know for sure that I'd go to heaven. When other people are coming to pray, would you slip from your seat? Just come here to the front. We'll have someone take you to a private room and take a Bible and show you how you can know you're on your way to heaven, straight from God's Word. There's only one way, and that's the Bible way. And we'll show you from God's Word how you can know you have eternal life and you can be on your way to heaven. Greatest decision you'll ever make in your life is, where will I spend eternity? Don't leave tonight without settling that. In a moment I'll pray and we'll stand to our feet and the pianist will begin to play. Brother Bob will sing an invitation hymn. Folks will begin to come forward to use the altar. Just slip from your seat. I'll meet you at the front. Let someone take a Bible and show you how you can know Christ as your Savior. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to hearts tonight. Thank you for hands have been uplifted, indicating you've spoken to their heart. I pray, Lord, that Christians will make the decision that you're speaking to their heart about. I pray that those in the room who are not certain about their eternity, they would come and let someone show them from the Bible how they can absolutely have it settled. Walk out the doors tonight with the peace in their heart that they've done what the Bible says to do, to know they have eternal life. May your will be done in every heart and life during this invitation now. And I'll thank you for it. Quietly with your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. You come tonight, will you? That's right. That's right.
Thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art Thou. If ever I love Thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love Thee because Thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love Thee for wearing the thorns on Thy brow. If ever I love Thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll love Thee in life, I will love Thee in death, and praise Thee as long as Thou lendest me breath, and say when the death do lies cold on my brow, if ever I love Thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore Thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown on
my Jesus, 'tis mine.
All right, be seated for a minute if you would, please. Appreciate your attention this evening. We're pleased to have Bruce Slabaugh coming tonight, and Bruce has been in RU for a while, and God's doing some great things in Bruce's life, and it's just phenomenal to see his growth in the Lord. And talking on the way home from the conference, he shared with me how he was saved as a boy, but he hadn't been scripturally baptized, and he said, I need to take care of that, and I agreed with that decision. That he needs to take care of that, and so we decided tonight to be a great night to do that with the RU testimonies and everything. And so Bruce is going to obey the Lord in baptism tonight. Amen? Isn't that great? So, Brother Bruce, right here, you stand up for everybody. We'll see you there. Go follow Brother Wallace downstairs, and he'll get you all set. And we'll help Bruce obey the Lord in baptism tonight. That's exciting. It's great. And family, so glad you're here to see him. And I know that you're seeing some changes in his life that are good, and that's what God does. And there's more to come in his life, I'll guarantee it. He's going to continue to the next stop. And I talked to him on the trip. I said his next thing God's going to take away from him is the cigarettes. Okay, it's coming, and it's coming. And he went 7-8 hours without one because he's driving in my car. Okay, so it worked out that way, amen. And God's going to do it, though. He really is. He's yielded the Lord. He wants to do what God wants him to do, and that's going to be a great victory for him. And I think God's got some great plans for his life. I want to mention this. I meant to do it during the offering prayer, but Brother Don Taylor's brother, Dave Taylor, his great granddaughter, who will be 2 years old, was 2 years old in July, or will be. Don went down with him. It just says 2 years old in July, so I'm taking this next year, or this coming few months away. Anyway, she had a seizure last night, and they even had to do CPR. She's at Children's Hospital now, and they're running tests to see what happened. Everly, E-V-E-R-L-E-E, Everly Riley is this little girl's name. And so pray for her, would you? Pray for the family. It's a difficult thing to go through, and a little one like that doesn't know what is happening or what's going on. And so let's pray for the doctors to have wisdom there, to Lord reveal to them what's going on in her life. Okay, Everly Riley. Okay? Brother Bob?
We got the hands going already. We're going to sing a few of your favorites. Julie, what's your favorite song? What song would you like us to sing? 317. 317. We'll sing a few songs while they're getting ready downstairs. And if you have a song that we haven't sung for quite some time, we'll see if we can fit it in here. 317 on that first together. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us.
Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy
tender care. Come on now.
Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are.
All right, I got to ask, how many, that's the first time you've sung that? Hands up all across the, yeah, that's what I thought. Good, I'm glad to hear that. Otherwise, you guys are just dead tonight. All right, yes, ma'am. 257, 257. You guys usually sing a lot better than that, so that's good. Farther along, tempted and tried, we're made to wonder.
Tempted and tried, we're off made to wonder. Why it should be thus all the day long, while there are others living about us, never molested, though in the wrong.
farther along, we'll know all about it. Farther along, we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. Denise? Victory in Jesus. What is that, 341? Is that right? Yes, 341. We'll sing this RU style, all right? I heard an old, old story. Sing it now. How he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me, so with his redeeming blood. Praise God, he loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
This is Bruce Slabaugh. Bruce, upon a public profession of your faith in Christ as your Savior, and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of Jesus' death, and raised in the likeness of Jesus' death.
Amen.
And the servant said, Master, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room.
Amen. Let's sing that first together. Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He exchanged a sinner for the sinless one. Jesus left his throne on high, came to earth to bleed and die. He said, Father, not my will, but thine be done. Mine, I have pardon full and free through the blood he shed for me. Say forever I shall be, he is mine. Amen. Yes, sir. Number 9. God can do anything, anything, anything. God can do anything but fail. God can do anything, anything, anything. God can do anything but fail. He can save, he can keep, he can cleanse, and he will. God can do anything but fail. He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. God can do anything, anything, anything. God can do anything but fail. That's another one we haven't done in forever. How many have never heard that one before? Including the one that asked for it. That's what I thought. Let's sing that one more time. That's a good one to remember and learn. All right, let's do that again. God can do anything, anything, anything. God can do anything but fail. He can save, he can keep, he can cleanse, and he will. God can do anything but fail. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He is the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. God can do anything, anything, anything. God can do anything but fail. Amen.
All right, let's stand together. Been a good day, hasn't it? Wow. And a wonderful crowd here this evening. Sunday night church is alive and well. Amen. Great to see you. All right. What did they do? Let the nursery free? All right. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you, Lord, for a wonderful Lord's Day. Thank you for these decisions that have been made for you throughout the day. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord. Now dismiss us with your care. Make us mindful of your presence as we go from this place. Help us to please you this week in all that we do. Help us daily to sit at your feet and receive from you what we need to be able to live for you day after day. May others see Jesus in our lives. And it's in his name we ask it. Amen. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's sing it, all right? It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You are dismissed.